have never seen this room so full and so quiet. So that means that I don't have to introduce the speaker, because I think you all came, you know what you came for. So, but anyway, so this is one of the highlights of the year for ICTP and for Trieste. So we're very pleased to have Keith Thorne visiting, and he kindly agreed to give us a colloquium, even though he's in a very, very, very tight schedule. He just arrived at noon and leaving after the talk, essentially. And but he was generous enough to agree to address the whole audience here at ICTP and Trieste in general, and we are very happy that he did so. So usually you have to introduce a speaker, and it's hard to find something that you already don't know, but let me say some things anyway. Keep is famous for many things. I'll try to go to some of the highlights. He was a student in Caltech and graduated in 62. Then he went to Princeton to work with the great John Wheeler, who is a very big thing, because John was one of the greatest thinkers of the last century. And in that sense, he shared the same supervisor as Feynman and other great physicists. Then he came back to Caltech and again shared time with Feynman, and he was telling us some nice stories about Feynman at lunchtime. And he has been a major figure in the field of general relativity. He wrote this famous textbook called Gravitation, that Misner, Thorne, and Wheeler. Some people know call it the Black Bible. It has been a very influential book for many generations, in particular for my generation. We started learning many things from that book. Then he has been doing many other things, like writing popular science books. His books on black holes and on time warps was it's a very lively book to encourage people to learn more about many things about gravity, wormholes, and even many things that can be addressed with the general relativity and some quantum mechanics. But part of it also, he tells a lot of the history of the time, how things were working in the U.S., in Europe, in the Soviet Union, and so on regarding that subject. So it's a very lively book, and I really enjoyed it many years ago. And I'm sure if you haven't read it, I would recommend it. Very visionary somehow. Keep just came with supporting the idea of searching for gravitational waves many years ago, and he has been the major figure on that, up to the level of the great discovery, probably one of the greatest discoveries of all time in the last couple of years, of gravitational waves from the merging of two black holes, and that very fairly justified that he shared the Nobel Prize in physics last year. Usually when I give talks, I was used to give that as a prediction of my talks. You saw there will be Nobel Prize 2017. That has been the only prediction that have been successful so far. So Keep is also now a public figure also, because of his participation with the famous movie Interstellar. So we don't know, they recognize him in the street because of Interstellar, because of gravitational waves, or because of Nobel Prize, or all of together. So that came out also relatively recently. And I know that he was telling us that he's also working for a future movie in collaboration with Stephen Hawking. So I cannot tell you more about that, and he cannot tell you more about that neither. That brings also the figure of Stephen Hawking that we sadly lost this year. That's one of the memories I personally have about Keep, is that I consider for my time in Cambridge that Keep probably was the closest friend to Stephen. He came to visit Stephen in very difficult times, and he was flying all the way from California to always be with him. And that's something that we all appreciated being in Cambridge, and I'm sure Stephen appreciated it. So that brings me to an anecdote that I didn't tell you this lunch, but it's something that's the only original thing I can say that you haven't heard, is that for Stephen's 70th birthday, there was a big celebration, it was a major dinner, And as usual, I forgot to register for dinner. And then when I realized it was too late, and then the organizer told me, okay, anyway, dress up, come to the dinner, and if there is someone canceled, we can fit you in, because otherwise everything is fit. So I did that, a black tie, appeared at the dinner in Trinity College in Cambridge, and actually someone canceled, and it was Stephen. Stephen was sick, he canceled, so I was given Stephen's chair. And so who was beside Stephen? The top person to be with Stephen. So poor Kip had to share time with me instead of Stephen, so I don't think he was very disappointed. But that already illustrates how close he was to Stephen. So anyway, so I don't take most of the time, so please join me to welcome Kip Thorne.
Generous introduction. I want to begin with a quotation from Stephen Hawking. Can you hear me? That's how he always began his lectures, but you didn't answer me. Can you hear me in the back? Yes, okay. I want to talk for physics students, physics researchers, and people with other backgrounds who know some amount of physics about an area of physics that is not often discussed, but one that I think is very interesting and is likely to have major discoveries in the next few years. This is what John Wheeler called geometrodynamics, by which he meant the nonlinear dynamics of curved space-time. And so my lecture does begin with John Wheeler. This is a photograph I took of John when he was giving a lecture in Cambridge, England, Stephen's home area. This is Willie Fowler, a dear colleague of ours, with a bald head there. He had a little bit of hair around it. I don't share that hair. John was talking about the nonlinear dynamics of curved space-time, black holes, wormholes, and other things whose existence and dynamics is owed to space-time curvature. And this was in the 1960s. In the 1950s and 60s, he was telling us, his students and his colleagues, that it would be very interesting to study geometrodynamics and learn how space-time behaves in what I would call a storm, when it's highly excited and changing very rapidly, highly warped, changing very rapidly. And he urged us to try to solve Einstein's general relativity equations to figure this out. And so we tried and we failed. Before I tell you about the failures and ultimate success, let me just remind you that nonlinear dynamics elsewhere in physics plays a very interesting role. Fluid turbulence, tornadoes, owe their existence to nonlinear dynamics of the fluids. Phase transitions in condensed matter, nonlinear optics, all of modern optical technology involves nonlinear dynamics in some manner. Colliding solitary waves in fluids, plasmas, in nonlinear crystals and optical fibers. And in mathematics, chaotic maps, strange attractors, all of these fancy buzzwords, they are aspects of nonlinear dynamics. And so nonlinear dynamics is really very interesting throughout physics, engineering, and modern technology. And so the question here that John asked us is, what kind of nonlinear dynamics do you have in curved space-time? And he challenged us to explore that initially in the 1950s. He wrote a book called Geometrodynamics with that title in 62, which was basically a compilation of his early papers on this. From 1958 to 1998, all we had were analytical techniques with pencils and paper, and we made very little progress. John foresaw this, and he encouraged his students and colleagues to develop numerical relativity, develop the techniques to solve Einstein's equations on computers. And the first work with numerical relativity was by his students, by Richard Lindquist, by Charles Misner, Karen Hahn, who was a computer scientist. She was a computer scientist at IBM. And then Bryce DeWitt took this over and then turned it over to younger generations of people, Larry Smarr and various younger people. But it took 4 decades to near fruition. Around 2000 in the 1990s, this began to be mature enough that you could start to learn about geometrodynamics with computer simulations. But it took 15 more years to get sufficiently mature by about 2012 that we could really begin to study geometrodynamics in depth in generic situations. So I'm going to tell you this history and then look into the future as to where this is going. I'm going to talk about 4 arenas for geometrodynamics. Geometrodynamics near space-time singularities. I'll explain what these words mean in a few minutes. Nonlinear self-coupling of gravitational waves and what's called critical gravitational collapse. The collisions of black holes, which create what I call a storm in the geometry of space-time. And finally, gravitational wave observations of the geometrodynamics that you get when black holes collide. So those are the topics that I'll talk about, 4 topics, 4 areas in which we have had major progress, including now the observational side of things. So this is now both a theoretical subject area and an observational subject area, thanks to this discovery of gravitational waves. And this was one of my motivations for working on a gravitational wave experiment. I could see that this would be the ideal way, the only way, really, observationally, to study geometrodynamics. So let me begin with geometrodynamics near singularities. This is a fairly old story, but a story in which I was personally involved, but on the sidelines. It was my colleagues, my friends who were doing this. It begins with Robert Oppenheimer, who, although he was much older than me, an earlier generation, I did know at the Institute for Advanced Study when I was a student. He and his student, Hartland Snyder, in 1939, gave the first calculation of the implosion of an idealized star, really a cloud of dust, imploding to form what we now call a black hole, with a singularity at its center and a black hole horizon around it. And we could look at that solution for the final black hole called the Schwarzschild solution of Einstein's equations. And we could see in the equations of that solution, the thing that you hear about if you hear stories of black holes, the astronaut, or in this case my wife, who falls into the black hole or hangs here, and is squeezed from the side by tidal gravitational forces and stretched from head to foot because, of course, the gravitational pull on her feet is stronger than on her head. Her head is farther away. And so that difference in the gravitational pull constitutes a net stretch on her. This is the tidal gravitational forces, the same tidal gravitational forces as produce the tides on the Earth created by the moon and the sun. From the period to 1939, when Oppenheimer and Snyder explored this, saw what we now call a black hole form, until the 1960s, there was great debate, great confusion, great controversy over whether singularities, like you have at the center of the black hole, where these tidal forces become infinitely strong, do they really form in the real universe? And what many, perhaps most physicists believed in that period from 1939 to the 1960s was Oppenheimer and Snyder studied a very idealized, absolutely spherical collapse of a star. But if you had a star that, or dust material that imploded in a more generic way, so it was not spherical, so there was rotation, that the particles would go in, they would fly around each other and fly back out and no singularity would form. And this, I think, was the dominant view from the 39 until the early 1960s. Landau had a great school of theoretical physics in Moscow, in Russia, and two of his young colleagues, Yevgeny Lifshitz and Isaac Kolatnikov, in 1960 completed a long calculation using analytic techniques, pencil and paper, with the Einstein equations, in which they used various approximation techniques, perturbation theory type techniques, and other analytical approximations to try to figure out what goes on, and they came up with an answer that indeed you will never get a generic singularity. You'll never get a singularity if you begin with generic arbitrary initial data and you implode some object, it will not form a singularity. And they codified this in a textbook called The Classical Theory of Fields, the edition of the book that I studied as a student. It was the second English edition, I think, the fourth Russian edition, published in 1962. There's a section about the absence of singularities in the general cosmological solution, really in the general solution of Einstein's equations, and a long analysis explaining why this doesn't happen. This is a picture of Lifshitz and of Landau that I got from Lifshitz's wife many, many years ago, because I spent a lot of time in the 1960s, 70s, and 80s in Moscow. Well, in 1965, Roger Penrose, a young mathematical physicist then working in London, introduced a whole new way to try to understand what Einstein's equations say. He introduced the field of mathematical subject of differential topology into general relativity. Previously, general relativity had been studied only using techniques of analysis, not techniques of topology. That is, geometric techniques and analysis techniques, but no topology. And using these new techniques, not new to mathematicians, but new at the time to relativity theorists, he was able to show, in technical language, that time-like world lines end inside a black hole. What that means, that you, if you fall into a black hole, you move along a time-like world line necessarily, and you die. You cease to exist. But why you cease to exist, he couldn't say. He could just prove that this is what happened in a general situation. His techniques couldn't say anything about the details of the singularity where you ceased to exist. He presented these results actually in a conference in London in 1965 that I attended, Lifshitz and Kolatnikov attended. Lifshitz and Kolatnikov were rather disturbed by this, because basically Penrose was saying, you were wrong, your analysis is wrong, I don't know why your analysis is wrong, but I am giving you a rigorous analysis, you had an approximation analysis, and you made a mistake somewhere. And so from then until 1969, Belinsky, a young student of theirs, together with Kolatnikov and Lifshitz, struggled until 1969, they discovered the error. And I remember I was in Moscow, I think it was 69, maybe it was 70, when they had just discovered the error, and Lifshitz gave me a manuscript to submit in his behalf to Physical Review Letters. In that era, they could not send a manuscript out to the West until it had gone through the censors. And he did not want to delay sending this through the censors because he wanted to be the one who could confess that they had made an error, did not want somebody in the West to point out their error. And so he wanted this published as quickly as possible to demonstrate that they had found the error. And so I carried this out and submitted it to the Physical Review Letters for him. And as far as I know, he never got into trouble with it. This is a photograph of Lifshitz, Kolatnikov, and Belinsky, together with me and John Wheeler here. The photograph was taken by Charles Misner when John and Charles and I were visiting Moscow a few years later. And so what was the mistake? Well, the mistake was basically that they had tried to find the general solution to Einstein's equations near a space-like singularity, one that can be reached through a series of space-like slices in space-time, and they had missed the general solution. They just simply missed it. The general solution was much more complicated than they expected. It turned out to be a generalization of something called the Mixmaster singularity that was discovered independently by them and by Charles Misner, and this was a generalization of it. And the story goes like this. As you approach the singularity according to their approximate analysis, and you move along this time-like world line, your friend moves along that time-like world line, time is plotted up in space horizontally as we do in relativity, you become causally disconnected from your friend. There's no way for you to influence each other because of the nature of space-time. In some sense, you're moving farther and farther apart. You're losing causal contact with each other. But you're each moving along a time-like world line. And as a result, the partial differential equations, Einstein's partial differential equations, can be approximated by ordinary differential equations in time as you approach the singularity. And these could be solved then by standard techniques. But the issue was, how fast do they decouple? How strong is the decoupling? And that was where there was a lot of criticism of this. The resulting temporal dynamics, as I say, is what was called mixed master. Matter has negligible influence on this. And so here's the description of this mixed master dynamics. It comes from my book from many years ago, Black Holes and Time Warps. So I'm plotting upward. I remind you, as you approach a black hole singularity of the sort that was found by Oppenheimer and Snyder, as you approach the black hole singularity, you get scratched from head to foot and squeezed from the sides. But what happens as you approach this general singularity is that the stretch and squeeze oscillate. And so in, say, the east-west direction, you have a squeeze. So I'm plotting stretch up and squeeze down. You have squeeze, 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 squeeze. But in the north-south direction, you have a squeeze, then a stretch, then a squeeze, then a stretch in a solitary way. And in the up-down direction, the opposite, stretch, squeeze, stretch, squeeze. So the three different axes, three different directions behave differently. There are principal axes involved in this. The mathematics is that of a symmetric trace-free tensor, which has three principal axes, along which you have the pattern of squeeze, 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 or stretch, squeeze, stretch, squeeze, or squeeze, stretch, squeeze, squeeze, stretch. But then there comes the end of these cycles. They make up an era, and at the end of these cycles, the principal axes of stretch and squeeze rotate in some manner that's governed by spatial curvature. And then the whole pattern begins all over again. And this entire pattern is described by a chaotic mathematical map, sometimes called a continued fraction map. So analytically, they discovered that in geometrodynamics, you do have chaos. You do have chaotic dynamics, like mathematicians and physicists study in other areas of nonlinear dynamics. So this was quite an amazing discovery. But in the West, by the West I mean Europe and the United States, where perhaps influenced by Penrose and others, and many others, there was a demand for a higher level of rigor. There was enormous skepticism. And so this began to be called the Belinsky-Kalatnikov-Lifshitz, BKL conjecture about how geometrodynamics goes, which had been attempted to be proved by heuristic arguments. And throughout the English, particular French and American literature, these phrases were used. You would find them over and over again: heuristic arguments, BKL conjecture. It was only when numerical relativity became sufficiently mature that it was possible to solve Einstein's equations to explore this conjecture, that a program was developed, originally devised by Beverly Berger and Vince Moncrief. He was at Yale, Beverly was at Oakland University. Beverly went on to become our program director for LIGO and for gravitational physics, the second program director, played a huge role in Washington for LIGO. But she's a superb mathematical physicist, and she and Vince started this. David Garfinkel at Oakland University was the main person who really pulled it off in the end, and through numerical simulations showed that indeed the BKL conjecture was almost correct. A few things had been missed, such as sharp spikes that occasionally occur at the end of a cycle, and the rotation of axes could sometimes be different than they had it. But the overall general picture was pretty much the way they had it, that geometrodynamics near a space-like singularity is almost precisely the way B, K, and L figured it out using approximation techniques. But we could only know for sure as a result of numerical simulations. Inside black holes, it turns out there are three different kinds of singularities. There's a BKL singularity, And there are two other singularities. And we know this also from perturbation analyses, approximation techniques. And I like to describe this in the context of the movie Interstellar. In Interstellar, you'll learn from Romilly, who's the theoretical physicist who gets killed by the explosion of a robot named Kip. Not to be confused with me, because Kip the robot has two P's on the end of his name. But Romilly says that there are three singularities, and when Matthew McConaughey goes inside the black hole, he should try to go into one of the gentle singularities. So the BKL singularity is very chaotic and very dangerous. This is an embedding diagram of the geometry of space as seen from a higher dimension, the bulk or the fifth dimension of Interstellar. An embedding diagram of the geometry of space-time. This is just my artist's conception of the BKL singularity. Once you go through the horizon, then in a rocket ship, you're headed toward the BKL singularity. And the BKL singularity, for those who know about Penrose diagrams, sits up here in a Penrose diagram of the external universe, the region inside the black hole between the event horizon and the outgoing Cauchy horizon, and then the BKL singularity. This is just for the experts in relativity who know what this means. And what was shown by Eric Poisson and Werner Israel in 1994, I can describe in physical terms this way, that after you fall into a black hole, time is so compressed inside the black hole that everything else that falls into the black hole after you comes crashing down on you in a fraction of a second, as seen in the inside. So there's a shock wave, an enormously strong shock wave that consists of everything that will fall into the black hole in the entire future of the universe. And that constitutes a singularity, but it's a gentle singularity in this sense, that the tidal forces, which are a relative acceleration between your head and your feet, if you do two time integrals of an acceleration, you get a displacement. So you do two time integrals of the tidal forces, and that's finite. Which means that this is just the net squeeze or net stretch in the up-down direction. That's the net squeeze in the up-down direction. The net stretch is finite by the time you hit the singularity. This is a very different kind of a singularity. Turns out to be a null singularity. And it is understood, however, only through perturbation theory thus far. And there is an outflying singularity similarly caused by everything that fell into the black hole in the past. A little bit gets scattered back up toward you, compressed into a shock wave, where, again, the second time integral of the tidal forces is finite. There have been no computer simulations that I know of yet of the interiors of black holes to see whether or not this picture is correct. This is the picture we have from these perturbation theory analyses. And so that is what one of the things I would be working on if I were working in numerical relativity is to try to understand this for sure. Is this really the way things behave or is it not? So simulations are greatly needed. I want to now turn to my second example, geometrodynamics in imploding waves. This is famous work that begins with Matthew Chopczuk, a postdoc at the University of Texas, when he did an analysis of the implosion of a wave that he wanted to make it as simple as possible, so he wanted it to be spherical, and this wave is to implode toward a sender. It carries energy, and if it implodes toward the sender, that energy might be enough to form a black hole. Now, the problem with gravitational waves, which are the only kind of wave that's just made from curved space-time, that's the only geometrodynamical wave, is they can never be spherical. It's a theorem, basically, that the only kind of a wave that can be spherical is a scalar wave. And so Chopczuk did an analysis of a scalar wave that satisfies the usual scalar wave equation, for those physicists who know about this, the usual linear scalar wave equation. But he then said, look, we know what the energy density is associated with the scalar wave or the scalar field. And so we will compute the energy density and the stresses associated with this scalar wave. And we will feed those into Einstein's equations as a source for space-time curvature. And then the scalar wave is going to interact with that space-time curvature that it itself has produced through its own energy. And so he did that analysis, and he found something really quite amazing. If he began with a scalar wave with an arbitrary shape, it didn't matter what the shape was. Here's a very simple Gaussian shape with some height, p. If p was bigger than some critical value, it would form a black hole. The waves came in. Their energy was just enough to form a black hole. A black hole would form, and the mass of the black hole was proportional to the amplitude of the wave minus some critical amplitude to some power beta, which he found numerically was 0.374. He couldn't calculate it analytically. This was all computer simulations. And if the amplitude was less than the critical value, then the wave would come in, interact with itself, and then disperse, and there would be no black hole forms. But he asked then, what was the minimum radius of curvature that you could get from this? A very, very tight curvature. Or one over that radius of curvature is a length scale. You can think of that as a measure of the total curvature of space-time. And that scaled is p star minus p to the same beta power. So didn't matter whether you which side of this transition you were on, whether the amplitude was big and you got a black hole or small and you didn't get a black hole, you constructed something that had the dimensions of length. And that thing that you constructed, the mass of the black hole in relativity, when we set Newton's gravitational constant speed of light to 1, is like we pathological physicists, relativity theorists like to do, found that the scaling was always with this same critical exponent. And if the amplitude was equal to the critical value, then quite remarkably, the evolution was what we call discretely self-similar. Basically, this wave went in, it interacted with itself, and it sent out then an outgoing wave, which had some shape. And then the same shape was repeated again, but on a much smaller scale, and then again on a much smaller scale, and then again on a much smaller scale, faster and faster, smaller and smaller scales. This is discrete self-similarity. I like to think of this as an organized frothing of space-time in the outgoing wave. These behaviors are like what you see in condensed matter in a phase transition, critical behavior and scaling. This is a phase transition when you change your initial data from the initial data that form a black hole to those that don't form a black hole. And so in this example then, this was our second example of geometrodynamics, we were seeing the same kinds of behaviors you see in very interesting phenomena of phase transitions in condensed matter physics. The next step then was to do the same thing with gravitational waves. And this was done initially by Abrahams and Evans at the University of North Carolina, and then by Yevgeny Sorkin with higher accuracy. Now the waves, because they're gravitational waves, they could not be spherical. They were actually symmetric. They were symmetric around this axis, but they had a different shape up here than they had in the equatorial plane. And it didn't matter what shape, precise shape you put in, the behavior was still the same. If the amplitude is bigger than a critical value, the mass of the black hole scaled in the same way with the same exponent to within the accuracy of the numerics. If the amplitude was less than a critical value, the strength of the curvature scaled in that same way with the same exponent. And so it's really quite and there's moderately strong evidence for discrete self-similarity. It seemed to be the same regardless of what kind of a wave you imploded. So this universality, again, something that you see elsewhere in nonlinear physics. Turns out that more detailed studies of other kinds of implosions have revealed that there's not just one universality class. There are several universality classes, several different behaviors, but a discrete number of behaviors. In some sense, like the, for those who know about this, the discrete number of roots to turbulence in convection of, say, oil in a frying pan. If you put oil in and you study it very carefully, the onset of convection, there is a discrete set of roots to of chaotic evolution, or evolution into the chaotic state of convection. So this is, again, like what you see elsewhere in nonlinear dynamics. Numerical studies are still in their infancy. I think there's a great richness remains to be uncovered. Okay, now I want to go to my third example, geometrodynamics in collisions of black holes. This is a diagram that I drew a sketch for, and then we had an artist make a nice version of the diagram when we were beginning to work on LIGO together in the 1980s. And this was our guess as to what it would look like for two black holes to collide. Again, as seen in an embedding diagram, looking in from a higher dimension, with the two black holes going around each other, spiraling together, merging, colliding and merging, and producing outgoing gravitational waves. We could, from dimensional analysis and knowing some approximate analyses, we knew that the power output of the gravitational waves would be somewhat bigger than the luminosity of all the stars in the universe put together during the collision. We now know from numerical relativity that factor is 50 for the particular case of the first gravitational wave burst that LIGO saw. It depends on the details, but for that particular initial one, is we got off three solar masses of energy in a time of about a tenth of a second. And the power output, energy per unit time, was 50 universe luminosities. Quite striking. And the really remarkable thing about this is there's no electrical charge involved in the collision of two black holes. So there's no electromagnetic radiation. There's only gravitational waves, nothing else. So they're our only tool for exploring this. Except, of course, if there is an accretion disk around the two black holes, it would be disturbed by the collision of the two black holes, and maybe we will get enough electromagnetic emission to see that. And the electromagnetic astronomers have been looking for that in our LIGO and Virgo black hole collisions that the LIGO-Virgo team has seen. But there have not yet been any electromagnetic emission found. So we're dealing truly with geometrodynamics, both observationally and then in computer simulations of this. And the key thing for me in the 1980s, when I became convinced by the year 1980 that the first thing we would see was what we did see, colliding heavy black holes, was that the details of the collision would be contained, the geometrodynamics would be encoded in the gravitational wave shapes, the stretch and squeeze plotted up and down. There'd be some shape, and this is a shape I drew in the early 1980s. Just drew it. No calculation, just my imagination of what I hoped we would see something like this. And it would contain the information about geometrodynamics. And so that was, for me, one of the most interesting goals of gravitational wave searches, was to begin to do observational geometrodynamics. So the numerical relativists worked very hard for 60 years to develop the tools of geometry to be able to simulate collisions of black holes. For a while, I was afraid that they would not have this under control by the time LIGO saw the waves and we would be in bad trouble, because in fact, the first black hole collision that occurred, all the signal power was in the epoch of the collision, which we cannot analyze. We don't know how to analyze in any way except through computer simulations. Fortunately, these superb computational physicists did have the numerical relativity under control by then. And so I'm going to show you now the collision of two black holes that was the first collision that we saw. And so this was from a simulation by Caltech, Cornell, Canadians for Theoretical Astrophysics, Cal State Fullerton, Oberlin, Washington State University. Anyways, a collaboration led by Saul Tucholsky of Cornell. It's called the SXS Collaboration for Simulating Extreme Spacetimes. And I'm going to then show you the spacetime metric or geometry of space-time in the collision that produced the first gravitational wave burst that LIGO saw. And so we know mathematically that if you have a curved two-dimensional surface, it can always be embedded in a flat three-dimensional space. That's a theorem that's not hard to prove. Except it's a theorem only locally, not globally. And there is a fundamental problem when you have black holes. If you go in around this black hole and march around and you build this surface that has the same geometry as the orbital plane of the two black holes. So we're looking only at the orbital plane as a two-dimensional surface. We're embedding that in a flat three-dimensional space. You go around and come back to where you started, it will not connect up smoothly. And so you have a problem. So Harold Pfeiffer, one of the young computational physicists in our collaboration, he said, I'm going to cheat. I'll tell people I cheated. I'm going to do a pseudo-embedding diagram. I'm going to plot upward something that has the dimensions of length. It's going to be 1 over the scalar curvature of this two-dimensional surface that is the equatorial plane of the black hole to the 1/2 power. And then I'll throw on minus the sign of the scalar curvature to make it look like an embedding diagram would look. And so that's what you're really seeing. But if you want to think heuristically, this is what it would look like to the bulk beings in the movie Interstellar looking in from outside at the black hole collision. And color coding is the slowing of time, or the so-called lapse function. The arrows are the so-called shift function, or gravity of space into motion. And you see the shape of space. This is now in slow motion. This is like a storm at sea, a huge splash, great slowing of time in the red region, then an oscillation, and gravitational waves propagate out. And that is a depiction of geometrodynamics for the first black hole collision, except this captures only a very small portion of the geometrodynamics. The problem is that too little of the space-time geometry is depicted in this way. First of all, we're only looking at two dimensions. And really, to see a gravitational wave and depict it, you need three dimensions. There's a stretching along this direction, a squeezing along that direction, and it's propagating in this direction. So you cannot capture the gravitational waves in this way. This is just the orbital plane. But if these black holes are spinning, they drag space into a whirling motion around themselves. They create a sort of a vortex in the structure of space around themselves, and you miss that entirely. There's a lot missing here. And so together with this is now work that I have done since I retired. I retired in 2009 in order to turn the leadership at Caltech over to the younger generation, in order to be in control of my own time and do what I wanted to do, in order to collaborate with students instead of teaching students. It's wonderful collaborating with students and having no responsibility for their education. Okay, so these are students and postdocs of my successor at Caltech, Yanbei Chen, who's my successor professor at Caltech. His students and postdocs, and I'm collaborating with them. And so we devised a way to visualize in vacuum, when there's no matter around, what's called the Riemann curvature tensor, which is the thing that describes the curvature of space-time locally. And I'm going to now get a little bit technical and talk about this in the same language that we talk about the electromagnetic field. Okay? And I'm going to remind you that if you have an electric field and a magnetic field in one reference frame in special relativity, and you change reference frames, so say you're moving at high speed in that direction, the electric and magnetic fields change. The electric field and magnetic field the electric field you see is a mixture as you move relative to me. It's a mixture of the electric field and the magnetic field that I see. And so there's an apparently complicated transformation. And so the electric field, the magnetic field depend on your reference frame. They depend on how you move through space-time. Now, we're doing this in curved space-time, and so the analog of a reference frame is a choice of a three-dimensional surface, two dimensions on my screen because I have trouble describing three dimensions plus the fourth dimension of time. And so I just show you a two-dimensional surface that's really three-dimensional. It's a space, a slice of constant generalized time, and time is plotting, being plotted upward. And when you choose to what we call, say, in technical terms, foliate space-time into space plus time, when you choose a sequence of space slices, and you think of time as running perpendicular to those space slices, as in relativity, as in special relativity, once you have made that choice of space slices, then something called the electromagnetic field tensor, which is something that lives in space-time, it breaks up into an electric field and a magnetic field. But these electric and magnetic fields don't exist until you have chosen a sequence of space slices, the analog of choosing a reference frame. But once you've done that, then you can draw field lines, a magnetic field lines around the Earth, for example. Once you have chosen a reference frame, then you can draw the field lines that depict the magnetic field, and similarly the electric field. Well, in that same way, the Riemann tensor that describes the curvature of space-time, it's in vacuum, it's the same as something called the Weyl curvature tensor, and so I'm going to talk about it in the language of the Weyl tensor for mathematicians and relativists who know this, the slight stickiness of being in vacuum versus not being in vacuum. But think of this as the so-called Riemann tensor. The time-space part of this, where space is along this surface, time is perpendicular, is called the tidal field. It's a symmetric trace-free tensor. And the dual, mathematically, that I won't go into, but for those who know about mathematical duals, the dual of that, the time-space part of the dual, is called the frame drag field. It's also a symmetric trace-free tensor. And these two tensors, which you can think of as 3x3 matrices, if you wish, they embody the entirety, everything there is to know about the curvature of space-time locally. So I'm getting into some slightly deep mathematics, but it's mathematics that should be in every relativity textbook and is in only one relativity textbook so far. It's the relativity section of the thickest physics textbook you have ever seen. It sits in your library. It's called Modern Classical Physics, and I just published it together with Roger Blandford, and that's why this is in there, because I'm one of the authors of this book. So if you want to read about this, you have to go to Modern Classical Physics. Okay. Now, this tidal field has the following physical meaning. If you have two particles, and they're separated by some separation vector, then because of the space-time curvature, this particle will be accelerated by some amount, delta A, relative to that particle. They're both freely falling, moving freely, but there will be a relative acceleration. And that example is just the stretching between my wife's head and her feet when she's near a black hole, the relative acceleration. That relative acceleration mathematically is minus the contraction of this tidal field into the separation vector. Minus sign is just historical. And the same thing happens in Newtonian gravity. This tidal field in Newtonian gravity is the gradient of the acceleration, of the gravitational acceleration. It's the double gradient of the Newtonian potential. And the same equation holds in Newtonian physics in that way. And if I have a gyroscope at each particle, then the inertial frames at that particle, as described by gyroscopes, will rotate relative to inertial frames at this particle, as described by gyroscopes. And that relative rotation, differential rotation, is described by the contraction of the tidal field into the separation vector. And so two pieces of space-time curvature, one stretches and squeezes you, the other twists you, twists inertial frames, makes a relative precession of gyroscopes. And that's the entire story of space-time curvature. The tidal field is well known to people, not nearly so well known as this differential frame dragging. Okay, so now let me apply this to black holes. If my wife hangs above the equator of the black hole, and this is a fast-spinning black hole, she gets stretched. If she hangs above the north pole of the black hole, she gets squeezed. In the green regions, she's not much affected by the tidal field. More precisely, the normal perpendicular to the surface of the black hole, to the horizon. Normal part of this tidal field is what we call the tendicity. It comes from the Latin word for tendere, to stretch. Tendicity is the relative acceleration between her head and her feet divided by her height. She then is squeezed by this negative tendicity, stretched there by a positive tendicity. And as I say down here, ENN is the normal component of the tidal field. So this is a little complicated, but for the physicists who've studied this kind of things related to this, I think it's worthwhile getting some sense that the mathematics is relatively simple. It's the mathematics of vectors and tensors just applied to the situation. We take regions where the stretching is very large on my wife, and we call that a stretch tendex. A region where the squeezing is very large, it's a squeeze tendex. So a black hole has a squeeze tendex at its north pole, and when a squeeze tendex at the south pole, a stretch tendex at its equator. And that's the nature of the radial stretching and squeezing that she experienced. Outside the black hole, we can draw the analog then of electric field lines. We call these tendex lines. We look at the principal axes of stretch and squeeze, which I talked about before when I talked about the chaotic dynamics near a singularity. Principal axes along which she is stretched and squeezed are parallel to these field lines. The tendex line is an integral curve of an eigenvector of the tidal field. There are three eigenvectors of a symmetric trace-free tensor. There are three then tendex lines go through each point. And so my wife is stretched along this tendex line that's red. She's squeezed along that tendex line. She's squeezed along these tendex lines that spiral up. And this is the entire pattern of these tendex lines around a fast-spinning black hole. So that is the totality of the tendex, of the tidal field part of the space-time curvature. To simplify things, I just focus on regions with very large tendicity, strong stretch or squeeze. And so there is a tendex of very long, a very large stretching sticks out of the equator of the black hole. It's actually symmetric, so it's basically a cone that goes out of the black hole like this. And then there's a squeezing tendex that goes out of the North Pole, goes around, comes back in the South Pole. And those are the things I'll focus on. Now, as for the twisting, horizon vorticity is the angular velocity of a gyroscope at my wife's feet as seen by her head. But that's also the same as the angular velocity of her head as seen by her feet. If you take a towel, a wet towel, you squeeze water out of it. If your left hand sees your right hand going clockwise, then your right hand will see your left hand going clockwise. And so it's the same mathematics. So sticking out of the north pole of the black hole, there is a counterclockwise tendex, a counterclockwise vortex of twisting space. Out of the south pole, a clockwise vortex of twisting space. On the black hole, then there's a horizon vortex of strong counterclockwise twisting here and strong clockwise twisting there. Outside the black hole, the integral curves of the eigenvectors of this frame-dragging field are then tendex lines, and they basically guide the whirling twisting tendex of twisting space that sticks out of the black hole. So out of the north pole of the black hole, there's a counterclockwise tendex that's guided by these vortex lines, and out of the south pole, a vortex guided by these vortex lines. And here is the entire pattern of vortex lines around a fast-spinning black hole. The clockwise twisting vortex lines come out of the south pole, go around the north pole and back in the south pole. The counterclockwise ones come out of the north pole, go back in the south pole. And the regions of very strong twist of space, there's a counterclockwise vortex sticking out of the north pole, a clockwise vortex sticking out of the south pole. So I've been kind of complicated. This is just to give you some sense of the underlying mathematics. For the remainder of my talk, I'm going to focus on these vortices primarily that stick out of the black hole. A counterclockwise one in the north pole of counterclockwise twist, now to the south pole of clockwise twist. We can think of this physically as like a strong tornado of twisting space with opposite polarity sticking out of the two poles of a black hole. Okay, now, having understood this mathematically, these postdocs and graduate students with whom I collaborated did a computer simulation of the collision of two black holes for simplicity, a head-on collision with opposite polarity. So there's a clockwise vortex sticking up on this black hole, a counterclockwise vortex sticking up on that black hole. And so opposite twists on the black holes. They're identical black holes otherwise. The black holes then collide and merge, and these vortices of twisting space retain their individual identity. And now we have a black hole horizon. This is the horizon of the black hole that has four vortices of twisting space attached to it. We began with two vortices, one on each black hole. We now have four. It turns out that black holes don't like to have four vortices. That's a highly unstable situation. And so they work hard to get rid of at least two of the vortices. And in this particular case, you can see what happens in this simulation then. I'll show you the rest of it. Remember that it's the blue vortex up here on the right. The black hole collides, merges. Now you have a red vortex on the right. Now blue, now red. The vortices fight with each other and exchange vorticity. What was originally a clockwise vortex of twisting space has become a counterclockwise vortex of twisting space. And that was a big surprise when we saw it in the computer simulations. And so looking more carefully at the vortex lines, we found that the following is what happens. At the moment when the black hole goes green, there are no vortex lines sticking through the black hole. They have come off. So in this case, you have a blue set of vortex lines. This is a clockwise vortex of twisting space. Comes out of the black hole, around and back into the black hole in the southern end. A counterclockwise vortex goes out, around, and back in. So all along the red lines, it's a counterclockwise twist going out of the black hole, come back in. Along the blue lines, a clockwise twist going out of the black hole, come back in. And then the oscillation, these vortex lines pop off, and it turns out they embrace each other and form a torus. And this torus of embracing clockwise and counterclockwise vortex lines starts traveling outward at the speed of light. With every oscillation, you get a new torus, like a smoke ring, a sequence of smoke rings produced when the black hole oscillates. And it turns out that something called the Bianchi identities of general relativity in a freely falling reference frame, a local inertial frame, they look just like the Maxwell equations, the dynamical Maxwell equations. Time derivative of the tidal field is the curl of the frame drag field symmetrized. This thing is symmetric, that has to be symmetric, the 3x3 symmetric tensor, and the opposite sign in the other way. Because this mathematics is essentially the same as with Maxwell, we know in Maxwell's case, if you have a moving magnetic field, it generates an electric field. So the same thing happens here through the so-called Bianchi identities. As these vortices of twisting space travel outward, their motion generates tendencies of stretching space along the long axis of the ring and tendencies of squeezing space around the short axis. So now you have these remarkable smoke rings of twisting space, both kinds of twist embracing, and then they've generated these tendencies of stretching and squeezing space. And this, in fact, is a gravitational wave. LIGO only sees the stretch and squeeze. It doesn't see the stretching and the twisting. It doesn't see the twisting. It only sees the stretch and squeeze. We don't have the technology to see the twisting. But this is the true nature of a gravitational wave. It's all It's a stretch, a squeeze, a clockwise twist, a counterclockwise twist, all wrapped up in one entity, produced in this case by these vortices and tendencies that pop on and off of the black hole. If we have an orbiting collision, it's rather simpler. In that case, the vortices and tendencies stretch out in spiral patterns like the water from a whirling sprinkler or like the spiral arms of a galaxy as the final black hole tumbles around and around. But you have, again, interesting dynamics, but a very different kind of dynamics. I'm going to just jump over these just say that looking at this in greater depth, it turns out you have two kinds of gravitational waves created in a black hole collision. You have the waves that are generated by vortices that stick out of the black hole. And you have waves generated by tendencies that stick out of the black hole. They have opposite parity. So one is the analog of magnetic dipole radiation. The other, the analog of electric dipole radiation. And they shows up in very much the same way in gravitational waves. But this is the essence in colliding black holes of geometrodynamics as we now understand it. And with LIGO now, and I think you've most all seen photographs of the LIGO gravitational wave detectors, the numerical relativists are doing simulations of generic black hole collisions. Here's a black hole that weighs 60 times what the sun weighs. That one weighs 10 times what the sun weighs. This one spins around that axis with a spin angular momentum that's proportional to the length of the arrow. That guy around this axis with such a spin angular momentum. That's the direction to Earth. And the waveform depends on all these parameters, on the masses of the black holes and therefore their sizes, on the spins, directions of spins, the magnitude of the spins, and the direction to Earth. And so you can imagine computing these waveforms is not simple. This is part of why it took 60 years. It's a small part of why it took 60 years. But you get then interesting waveforms out. The name of the game now is from the observations by LIGO and Virgo. You get observed waveforms. You compare those with waveforms from simulations. When you get a very good match, you then go back to the simulation and you look at the geometrodynamics. If the match is essentially perfect, you say, well, the geometrodynamics presumably is the way the simulation says. And so that's what we are doing now. We have seen 6 black hole mergers thus far with a range of masses and distances. The farthest source was something like 3 billion light years. The heaviest mass in a collision was 36 solar masses, one of the first black holes we saw. The smallest one we've seen so far is 7.5 solar masses. But we are beginning to build a catalog of black hole collisions, and corresponding to that, a catalog of geometrodynamical behaviors of curved space-time, which go hand in hand with the catalog of the waveforms. So we have, think of ourselves as having a catalog of waveforms and then a dictionary that says, if you see this waveform, here's the geometrodynamics that goes with that waveform. So this is what the SXS collaboration is doing here. And so far, there's excellent agreement between the observations and the simulated waveforms. Okay, I'm going to finish off now by reminding you that in 1984, I speculated, I hope, that this is the waveform we would see. And the waveforms that we have seen, if I go back here, the ones we've actually seen are awfully simple. They're nowhere near as interesting as what I was hoping we would see. The actual waveform, for example, for the first gravitational wave we observed, this is the collision epoch, was just very simple. And the question is why, and the answer is that the black hole does not hang on to the gravitational disturbances that it creates very long. The disturbances depart very, very quickly. Correspondingly, as the black hole vibrates, the Q, the quality factor of the vibration, is very low. Just a few oscillations and the disturbance is gone. That's true of all the black hole mergers that have been seen thus far, but work by Huan Yang and Aaron Zimmerman, who were students of Yanbei Chen in what used to be my research group, together with Louis Lehner at the Perimeter Institute uh, uh, in Canada, they have pointed out, based on earlier work by Yang and Zimmerman and Yanbei Chen, that the following happens. If you have a slowly spinning black hole, the shape of space around it is a very gentle throat. If you have a fast spinning black hole, you get a long throat in the geometry of space. And so quite naturally, you can have gravitational waves that are trapped in this throat for a long time. So you have normal modes of oscillation of a fast spinning black hole that might be the final black hole from a black hole merger that live for a long time if the black hole is spinning very fast. We haven't seen a final black hole that's spinning very fast. We hope to at some time over the coming few years when we are by, say, 2020, 2021, we're seeing presumably something like one black hole merger per day instead of something like one per month when we're observing. And so the key issue is that from their calculations that they have done, combining some amount of computer simulation and a lot of analytical work, it turns out that if you have a rapidly spinning black hole, this is sort of a canonical fast spinning black hole number, for A, the black hole spin parameter, for those who know about these things, over M, 0.998. But that kind of a black hole spin, which it's conceivable we will see, the normal modes of oscillation can be held long enough that you get mode-mode coupling. Two modes interact with each other to produce a third mode. And it's that kind of mode-mode coupling that gives rise to turbulence in fluids. And in fluids, you begin with very large-scale modes, eddies. Think of them as circulating eddies. They interact. They produce smaller eddies. They feed their energy from big circulating eddies to smaller eddies, to smaller eddies, to smaller eddies, described by something called the Kolmogorov spectrum in fluid mechanics. What happens here, it turns out, is an analog of what happens in two-dimensional fluids, where the cascade of energy is from small scales to large scales, quite the opposite of what you see in ordinary three-dimensional fluid mechanics. Presumably, that's the case here because of the axis symmetry of the unperturbed black hole. The black hole is being perturbed. But their calculations suggest that LIGO and Virgo actually have hope to see the creation of two-dimensional turbulence in vacuum space-time. That is, these eddies, these normal modes interacting with each other and feeding energy from small scales to larger scales to larger scales to larger scales after a fast-spinning black hole forms from the disturbances that arise from the black hole collision. And so this is an example of the future that I'm hoping for, observations to match what is seen in these calculations. And so let me just finish off by saying that I've talked about four current arenas for geometrodynamics: singularities, imploding waves, colliding black holes, and gravitational wave observations. In all, I suspect we've barely scratched the surface. We now have the tools of numerical relativity, quite sophisticated now, on codes that are becoming public codes that other people can borrow and use. So real opportunities, though they're hard to work with, it's still early on in this business. But it's a community of people beginning to explore geometrodynamics. And I think the interplay between analytical calculations, computer calculations, and the observations of gravitational waves in this subject is going to be very interesting over the coming several decades. Thanks.
Thank you very much, Keith. It's a wonderful talk. And I'm sure there will be a few questions.
I'm sure everything was crystal clear, so there are no questions.
No questions, definitely. Yes, question, please.
You said we don't have the technology to detect the twisting of black holes, but naively, one would think that you just set up an interferometer to detect rotation.
Yes.
So where's the trick?
The issue is the sensitivity that you can achieve. And you're basically looking to measure an angle of rotation, a differential rotation. And angles are much harder to measure than just linear displacements. And so there was a conceptual design for a gravitational wave detector by Braginsky in Moscow and a young colleague in around 1970 for a detector that works off this twisting of space. But the sensitivity that could be achieved just did not look anywhere near good enough. And so I don't know any other effort that's gone into it. It could be that a good experimenter could design a detector that could actually do it. But that small amount of effort that was put in by Braginsky then did not look at all promising. So it's a question of doing the numbers and doing the experiment. And I could be wrong. I have been wrong many more times in my career than you can possibly imagine.
But you have been right at least once. Huh? More questions? Yes.
In the second event that was observed, there was also an observation with electromagnetic waves, if I'm correct,
yes.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
And so we were able to find exactly where did it come from. So the galaxy, which where the black hole was.
Except in this case,
stars.
It was neutron stars.
Neutron stars.
Yes.
Okay. Okay. So, but these waves were almost nothing here on the Earth, but near the neutron stars, it was a very powerful wave. So it must have brought havoc to the star systems which were nearby, I suppose. Is there anything that we can see in that sense?
So if you look at the numbers, by the time you reach, if you're in the near zone, so the wave has not yet fully developed into an outgoing wave, the tidal field, the frame drag field are enormous, and you don't want to be there. But by the time you get to the beginning of the wave zone, the dimensionless stretch and squeeze, the fractional change in your length, is something like a part in 1,000 or a part in 100. So it's really quite small. It's only in the near zone that the stretch and squeeze are so big that you would be highly uncomfortable or that it would really wreak havoc. Now, if you have two black holes going around each other and an accretion disk near it, the accretion disk may be near enough that there is significant influence. There will at least be influence of the loss of mass. You have a central body that suddenly has its mass reduced by 5%. And the disk has to respond in some interesting way with it, if there's just a sudden loss of mass that's holding the disk there. That's what the hope is. But that's the only place that I expect, from a nearby accretion disk, that I expect that there's going to be enough disturbance for us to be able to measure.
What are the long-term hopes for space-based observations? I mean, you know. Yeah.
So LISA, the laser interferometer space antenna, which is a ESA mission, European Space Agency mission, is very exciting. It's currently scheduled for launch around 2034. But there are two things have happened since that schedule was developed. The first is that LIGO has seen gravitational waves, and that has given a big psychological boost to the people who want to do this in space. The second thing is that there was a LISA Pathfinder mission to test technology in space, to test the most difficult of the technologies that are involved in LISA. And it was spectacularly successful, with results announced just about 2 months after the first gravity wave detections were announced. And so I think there's a big motivation to move forward as fast as possible on LISA. LISA is a wonderful mission. It looks, because you have spacecraft that track each other with laser beams, and the separation of the spacecraft is a few million kilometers instead of a few kilometers. It's a million times longer separation. You see gravitational waves with thousands to millions of times longer wavelength. And so you're looking at least space-based gravitational wave observations. When compared with LIGO and Virgo on the ground, it's like radio astronomy versus optical astronomy. And we will see completely different things. You'll see supermassive black holes. We have hopes of seeing the gravitational waves from the phase transition when the universe was 10 to the minus 12 seconds old, the phase transition in which the electromagnetic force was born through the electroweak force coming apart, creating the electromagnetic force and the weak nuclear force. We expect to be able to map with enormous precision the space-time geometry of quiescent black holes from the gravitational waves of small black holes that spiral around them on complicated orbits. So they're just absolutely wonderful science to be done with LISA. And it has gotten the highest conceivable ratings in terms of the science in various competitions in the US and I think in Europe. But funding agencies until now have been afraid of the technology. And with the success of the LISA Pathfinder mission, I think that fear is much reduced. And I am quite optimistic that this will move forward really well over the coming few years.
Paolo?
Yes, we received some questions from people looking at the colloquium online. And one of the questions is about a possible bet that you did with Stephen Hawking against other physicists. And he wanted to know about the status of the bet, or does the bet exist, and what is the status of that?
Which bet?
Yeah, I think about the information paradox.
Okay, the information paradox, okay. So this is a slightly complicated story. First, let me comment on the information loss paradox. This phrase, information loss, does not capture at all what's going on. The issue is that in quantum mechanics, if we could make arbitrarily good measurements, the best that are allowed by quantum mechanics, then if you begin, this is using some technical language, then the evolution of a system is always unitary. Another way to say it is you begin with what is called a pure state in quantum mechanics, and it evolves to a pure state. Another way to say it is information is never lost. These are three different ways of saying it. But Stephen Hawking gave strong evidence back in the mid-1970s that when a black hole when an object implodes to form a black hole, and then the black hole emits Hawking radiation due to quantum effects and slowly shrinks and disappears, that the evolution is not unitary, information is lost, that you go from a pure state to a mixed state. These are different ways of saying it. But fundamentally, what he did was gave strong evidence that the laws of quantum mechanics as we know them are wrong. And that's what this is all about. Are the laws of quantum mechanics as we know them correct, or are they not correct? And he gave strong evidence that they are not correct when you deal with the formation and then evaporation of a black hole. Since formation and evaporation of a black hole is actually controlled by the laws of quantum gravity, which we do not understand at all well, this is the question. The question are the fundamental concepts of quantum mechanics as we understand them, do they apply to quantum gravity? That's the basic issue. In this bet, Hawking and I said, no, they don't apply. There's something wrong with the laws of quantum mechanics. And John Preskill said, yes, they do apply. Standard quantum mechanics is correct. Stephen Hawking conceded the bet in a famous concession speech in Dublin, Ireland, at a big press conference with 50 reporters and TV cameramen at a conference there around 2005 or so, or something like that. I was the chair of the session at which he conceded. nobody paid any attention to me because I'm not Stephen Hawking, but I didn't concede. Stephen conceded. And so I am one of the few holdouts who still maintains that it is quite possible that information is lost, that the standard laws of quantum mechanics are wrong when applied to the laws of quantum gravity. And the reason that I'm a holdout is because we do know, much of this because of work by Murray Gell-Mann and James Hartle, but using techniques due to Richard Feynman, we know that there's an alternative way to formulate the laws of quantum mechanics, which is a way due to Feynman called the path integral approach or the sum over histories approach. And we know that that approach does allow you to lose information. It does allow you to have non-unitary evolution. It does allow you to evolve from pure states to mixed states. And that does arise if you include in your sum over histories with closed time-like curves. Histories with backward time travel. You only have some tiny probability amplitude for a closed time-like curve, but that's enough to destroy unitary evolution. So my personal guess is that information is lost, that the standard quantum mechanics is wrong, and that the correct formulation of quantum physics is Feynman's approach, and that all of the struggle that the community of physicists is having over what they call firewalls and various paradoxes that just are leading to enormous confusion, it's because my colleagues are refusing to admit that standard quantum mechanics fails. But having said that, I again reemphasize that I have been wrong so many times, it's not countable. And I am nowhere near as deep in this subject as John Preskill or Stephen Hawking or the other people who have the opposite view. I'm just an honorary contrarian. But I think this is a very deep and very interesting, very important question. And I believe that essentially everybody working in the field will agree with me that the final answer is not in. It still is not at all clear what is going on.
Very good. You don't feel bad about closed time-like curves? You're okay?
Pardon?
Having closed time-like curves is okay for you?
Closed time-like curves included in a Feynman path integral, I have no problem with that.
Right. So no problem with causality.
But I think that's the essential issue. That's the way that you lose unitarity is by including closed time-like curves in the path integral. And I think we know that from model calculations. So that's quite separate from the issue of closed time-like curves on a human scale. But the question is, in a path integral on arbitrarily small scales, say in the vicinity of the Planck length, do you have to include closed time-like curves?
Interesting. Paolo, any other question? Any other question from the...
No.
Not good. Okay.
There are many, but okay.
No.
I'm sorry, that was a long answer, but it's something about which I feel passionately, but on the other hand, I feel very insecure about my answer, but nevertheless, I feel passionate about it.
Right. And do you know if there is a better understanding of this Chopwick exponent now, or it's only numerical?
Yeah, so as far as I'm aware, there is no understanding as to why it has the value that is seen. But I have not followed that subject closely. And it is, as I also indicated, rather rich because it turns out that there are several universality classes of behaviors. And the one that I described was the first one was discovered, but it's only one of several. I think even in other places where you have critical exponents, there is not much understanding of why the critical exponent has the given value, as far as I'm aware. But again, I'm not close to this. Condensed matter physicists would know a lot more than I do about that.
Very good. And these spikes that you said that numerical relativity found that they were missed by Lipschitz et al. The spikes that were missed by... Do they have any implication? Do they add more to our some understanding? So
I don't think we understand the spikes terribly well. They show up in the simulations.
Okay.
They do, you can see in the mathematics that they arise due to spatial coupling when you come to the end of a cycle. And so this issue that I tried to highlight at the beginning of that discussion, that if you and your friend move toward the singularity side by side, you become spatially decoupled. The ordinary partial differential equations of Einstein become ordinary differential equations. That's not entirely true, and the spikes arise from a coupling between you and your neighbors. So the coupling is not complete, but it's, again, it's not a subject that I've looked into in depth, but I know that those who have tell me that this is where this arises.
Okay. And just my last point. You said that in the next couple of years we will see like one event per day.
Well, roughly. So we're extrapolating small numbers. It's impressive. Just go play with, say, even a Poisson distribution. If you have only eight numbers, you can be quite wrong in guessing what the distribution is. But based on what we have seen with those eight, it should be somewhere probably between a few a week and one a day when LIGO is and when advanced LIGO and advanced Virgo are at their design sensitivity.
Yeah. And can you foresee any surprises that you said, something completely unexpected that they could eventually see? This should not have been seen.
I do expect the big surprises. But this is only on general grounds, that every time a new kind of electromagnetic waves has been brought into astronomy, originally radio waves, then X-rays and so forth, there have been big surprises. As seen through radio telescopes, the universe is far more violent than through optical telescopes, and so there's a real revolution in our understanding of the universe in that sense in the 1950s and on into the 1960s. Similarly with X-ray astronomy. And so just on these general grounds that gravitational waves are so radically different from electromagnetic waves that you would expect there will be big surprises. The LIGO and Virgo team are working very hard to find surprises. And the issue is then how do you do data analysis looking for something you didn't expect? So there are many different data analysis channels that have been developed to try to find things that were unexpected. I'm pretty confident that will come. Whether it will come by the time we're at advanced LIGO's design sensitivity or not, I don't know. I hope. But that it will come in the next decade or so, some huge, huge surprise. I'm fairly confident just on these general grounds.
Very good. So it's a nice way to finish. But before we finish, since many of you haven't been here before for other colloquia, the tradition we have, and we will try to impose it today, it's very difficult because I can see many people, is that when we finish, there will be some refreshments outside, and everybody is asked to go outside for the refreshments, except and only except for the diploma students of ICTP, who will come down and will have a private meeting with Kip. Kip has kindly agreed to do it, and we usually do it. And everybody else can be waiting outside in the refreshment. So before everybody leaves, so please thank Kip again.